Hey, what is going on, guys? Our Red Stealth here, and in today's video, we're gonna be breaking down the ultimate guide to escape low elo for season 11. If you can take everything in and apply the concepts from this video to your future games, then I can guarantee you're gonna see way more success with your rank climbs for this season. So let's not waste any time at all and get right into it. The first step to escaping low elo is limiting your champ pool. 2 to 4 picks is what you want to aim for, and this has been proven time and time again as one of the easiest ways for you to shoot up in elo really fast. If you're constantly swapping around who you're playing, the ability for you to understand matchups and how your champion functions at certain points in that matchup will be really lacking. Limiting your pool is also really key because it reduces the amount of variables that are in each game. The only thing that you're in control of is who you're playing and how you play the game. So if you're first timing a new champion every couple of games or just playing picks that you don't play very often, then you'll have to spend so much more of your time in game just thinking about how your champion is supposed to function in certain situations. You'll be thinking about how to combo or whether or not you can fight your opponent instead of more important things. If you're playing someone you've spent hundreds of games on, then you can shift your focus onto things that actually help you improve as a player, like macro or decision making. Now you might ask as well, does it matter the difficulty of the champion I'm playing? And to answer that, not really. Yes, if you're playing an easier champion, it will take you less games to understand the champ and play them to their fullest potential. So if you want to climb the fastest and the most efficiently, I would recommend playing an easier champion. But if you want to put in the time, then even playing more difficult champions is fine. It's just gonna take you longer to climb. The key is to limit the size of your champion pool and be consistent with it. And having a champion pool isn't playing 10 games on a pick and then swapping that champion out. You have to spend upwards of hundreds of games on the same few picks for you to really understand them and allow yourself to climb. Another really useful thing that you can apply before you even enter a game is just analyzing win conditions in the loading screen. Take a look at your matchup, think about how you want to be playing the matchup early on. Can you be aggressive? Do you need to play back more? Do you need to scale in that matchup? Look at the enemy jungler. Think about, are they going to be ganking you early on? Are they an early game ganking jungler? Are they playing somebody like Lee Sin who tends to gank level 3? Or are they playing somebody like a Master Yi who doesn't have the greatest ganks early on, so you are allowed to play a little bit more aggressively? You can also be thinking about potential build options for that game so that when you're actually in a situation to where you need to purchase items, you're not sitting in base for like 30 seconds thinking about what you should be buying. Just taking a quick look at both compositions, if your team has some crazy strong crowd control, really good team fight, then grouping up in the mid to late game, playing for objectives, being as 5 is gonna be a really good win condition for you there. Gathering all this information while you're in the loading screen benefits you in a similar way to limiting your champion pool, because once you're in game, it allows for you to then focus on other things that are a lot more important. All right, the next one up here is just gonna be simply to mute all. Staying focused on what you need to do to win the game is so important. The moment you shift your focus and start reading the flame your teammates are typing to you in chat after a bad play, the chances of you winning that game go down drastically. Not only are you wasting time reading what they're typing, but it's likely gonna tilt you as well. So when you get back to playing, you're gonna make more mistakes or you're not gonna be playing according to what you set out your win conditions to be. Now, if your argument to not mute all is that you're gonna miss out on key information your teammates are trying to tell you, then that's just not really true. Sure, maybe 1 in every 20 games your teammate will type something useful, but it doesn't outweigh the amount of times players use chat for useless things like to flame. Muting all will allow you to really improve your mental and just start worrying about how you are playing and no one else. The game is also just so much more enjoyable and less stressful when you don't have your own 5 top laner flaming you because you didn't gank him when he died overextended with 0 wards all game. A really great way to improve quickly that not a lot of people actually do is looking at high elo VODs or just players that are better than you and just analyze what they do differently. So for example, say you're like a Riven top lane main, you're going up against a Fiora and you just had a really bad time in the matchup, you just lost lane and you don't really know what you did wrong. You can go on YouTube, type in Riven versus Fiora challenger gameplay and just take a look at how that Riven played the matchup. If she won lane, take a look at things that she did differently to you, and then just look to apply those things in your future games. The next one here is gonna be to play around your power spikes. These can be a certain level advantage. It can be hitting a level. It can be having a certain cooldown available, hitting a certain item. So a lot of players just kind of, you know, play the game out. They don't really think about, okay, when am I strongest? When should I be looking to fight? Say for example, you're playing Leona bot lane. She has an extremely good level 2 all in most of her matchups. So playing for that level 2, trying to hit it before the opponent, and then all inning is playing off of your power spike. Understanding and playing off of your teammates' power spikes are really important as well. Say for example, you have a Kasten who's level 14 or level 15, really close to that 16 spike there, then if you try to force a fight mid randomly, or if you're just trying to fight at all, then you're just not playing towards, you know, your power spikes or your win conditions. Let that Kasten farm up, let him get the 16, then when he hits that, then you look to fight around your power spike, and it's gonna give you a much better chance to win those games. Now, a big laning mistake that low elo players make is that they don't punish enemies when going for last hits or if they miss spells. If the enemy is going for a last hit, they're forced into a fixed position when they're auto attacking. So if you're playing a skill shot oriented champion, then using that skill shot on them when your minion gets really low and when the enemy goes in for that last hit is going to give you a much higher hit rate on that skill shot. Also, if they're just throwing out their skill shots at you and they're missing, or if they're using their skill shots on the wave, looking to punish them immediately after that is just going to drastically improve your laning phase. Stop dying to the 2-minute 45-second gank. This is something that plagues players really no matter the elo. You see it a lot more in the lower elos, but even up in the higher elos, you do see it quite often too. A lot of junglers, how they're going to look to path is they're going to go from blue, gromp, red, up to top lane for a gank, or they can do red, you know, blue, gromp, and gank bot lane. But you want to be aware of this timer. 2 minutes and 45 is around when most junglers can gank you at the level 3. Some junglers, it's going to be a little bit later, like 250, 255, but having a ward down at around 2 minutes and 30 seconds, 235 there is really important. Or if, you know, you don't have a ward for some reason, just playing more respectfully, if you don't know where the enemy jungler is at this timer, is really key. Now, a way for you to have an idea as to where the enemy jungler is pathing early on is by taking a look at which side lane arrives to lane first. In this game here, for example, you're gonna see that Garen ends up arriving to lane before his bot lane. So the gangplank in this game should realize that Elise is starting on the bot side of the map, or it's very likely she's starting bot side and she's going to be pathing towards top. It even looks like there's a ward here on Elise's red to start off the game. So the fact that gangplank overextended and ended up dying to this early Elise gank is even worse because of that. Now, not every single jungler in the game is gonna look to do a clear of red, blue, gromp, and then gank bot lane, but a lot of junglers in the game do, and especially in the lower elos, this is what a lot of junglers are gonna look to do every single game. So being aware of that 2:45 timer is very important. Look to improve your objective awareness and control. An easy thing that you can look to do is focus on when objectives are coming up, and about 1:30 before they spawn, just look to ping the objective out in chat for your team. If you can get in the habit of doing this, then it's not only going to allow yourself to really be aware of when objectives are coming up, but it's also gonna help your team, you know, understand, okay, this dragon's coming up in 1:30. We have to be ready for it. We gotta start rotating over, getting control of it. And if you can really just control objectives, improve your objective control in the mid game, force the enemy to face check into you, you're gonna find so much more success in your mid game. You get control, you get vision around dragon, the enemy face checks into you, you get a free pick, it becomes a 5v4 for your team, you get that dragon, the enemy team tries to fight the 5v4, you ace them, you take Baron, and the game is over. Stop playing so aggro without any jungle knowledge. If you don't have a clue as to where the enemy jungler is on the map, it's likely he's gonna be ganking your lane if you're pushing out and playing aggressive. That's almost always how it works. So a couple of different things you can look to do to deduce as to where the enemy jungler is on the map is take a look at where your jungler is. If your jungler is invading the enemy jungler's top side and you're playing like as a top laner, then you're pretty free to play aggressive. Then if you see your jungler like pathing through river and then pathing into the enemy's jungle. It's likely the enemy jungler is then going to be on the bot side of the map and you can play more aggressive then. But if your jungler, for example, is invading the enemy's bot side and you're playing as a top laner and he doesn't spot out the enemy jungler, it's likely he is going to be on the top side of the map. The enemy jungler is going to be on the top side of the map. So then in that situation, playing more safe, playing back is more ideal. You can also look to take information from how your lanes are playing. If you're playing like mid lane, for example, and your bot lane and your top lane are both sitting back at their tower, they're not playing very aggressive at all, then if you're playing up in lane, it's likely you're going to be the gank target. A lot of junglers in low elo just tend to gank the lane that's most easily accessible for them. The lane that shoved out the furthest, the easiest lane to gank, is where they're going to focus. So if you're the only lane pushing out, it's likely you're going to be the gank target. Never type unless it's to shot call. If you aren't typing something that is of use to your team to help you win the game, then don't even type at all. Nothing good ever comes out of flaming your teammates, and it's just a way for you to boost your ego and make yourself feel better in the moment. Everybody makes mistakes no matter what elo they're in, so trying to put blame on your teammates when you are likely making as many mistakes as them throughout the game will never help you improve as a player. Learning to type fast and effective shot call phrases like group at dragon, come top, reset, back off is all you should be typing in chat throughout the game. Dodge trolls are when you're off roll. Now, when you do get up into the higher elos, you can dodge a little bit more strategically, even based on like how many autofills you have on your team or if your teammates are playing like random champions. But in the lower elos, generally just dodging if you're off roll is very good thing to do. If you're not playing your main role, then you're just not going to perform as well. If you're just playing a random champion in a random role, the likelihood of you winning that game is very low. You're just looking to coin flip it. So if you have your -3 LP, then look to use it. And then also, if you do have trolls on your team, what you can do every single game is just copy paste your team into like op.gg, or there's other applications as well that you can use for this, and just take a look at your teammates match history. If you notice somebody on your team is like just trolling in their recent games, playing something like Pyke with Smite and he's just, you know, trolling every single game, or if you have like a Nunu with Ghost and Cleanse, then just look to dodge those kind of games as well. Now, one that really plagues a lot of low elo players is that they really dwell on their teammates' mistakes, and they focus so much time looking at replays or just in the game, you know, focusing on how bad their teammates played instead of focusing on themselves. Like I touched on briefly earlier, chances are you're gonna be making as many mistakes as your teammates throughout the game, but you just might not even be noticing them. So if you just only focus on what you can be doing to improve, when you're looking at replays, only look at what you could be doing differently. Don't look at, you know, what your teammates are doing wrong, because what they're doing wrong, you know, you're gonna run into that one player for that one game and you're probably never gonna run into them again. So focusing on what they're doing is completely useless. Only focus on yourself and what you can do to improve. All right, and then lastly here to round things out, guys, don't get too overwhelmed with trying to learn so many different things at once. Work on one thing at a time, get really good at that one thing, and then once you've kind of like mastered it, or once it becomes a habit for you, then move on to working on something else. So say, for example, you want to improve at CSing, your CSing is really bad or something, go into your future games and just hard focus on improving your CSing, get really good at it, you know, get to a point where you're getting much more CS than you were before and you're just consistently getting those CS scores up. And then once you've done that, once that becomes a habit for you, then move on to trying to improve at something else. One thing you really have to accept with using this strategy is that in the short term, it's likely not going to see a ton of LP gains, and it's likely not going to see a big increase in rank. But over the long term, if your main goal is to climb throughout the entire course of the season and really improve as a player, this is the way you should be doing it. All right, so that is going to be all for the video, guys. Hopefully this did help you out and you can look to apply a lot of the concepts we talked about in this video to your future games so you can see a lot more success in rank for season 11. If you guys did enjoy this video, then be sure to drop a like and subscribe if you have yet to already. So thanks for watching, have an awesome day, and I will see you in my next video.